everyone. I'm Meredith. And listen, I'm just a girl still stuck in my apartment, still looking for new people to talk to. Broadway producer and historian Jennifer Tepper is back with us today to talk about the new edition of her book series, The Untold Stories of Broadway. Volume 4 is out now. And in this more than a year time since Broadway has been shut down because of the pandemic, this new book may be about as inside we get to some of these sacred theatrical spaces. But before we get into all of that, don't forget to like and subscribe to the Let's Talk About It YouTube channel. I don't want you missing when new episodes come out. And make sure when you do, you hit that little notification bell right there so you never miss a video. Go ahead, like and subscribe, little notification bell too. Jennifer and I will wait. Okay, did you do it? Great. Jennifer, thanks so much for being here. Let's talk about it.
Thank you for having me. Excited to be back.
Thank you. You are our first returning guest, so I am extra excited for that. Thank you for coming back, and thank you for talking more about Broadway, all of its untold stories, what's going on in these crazy times. Lot to talk about.
Yes, a lot going on, even since we talked in October.
Yeah, absolutely. But let's start with this new edition, The Untold Stories of Broadway, Volume 4.
Yes.
I don't like to go look back too much anymore. I like always am looking forward, but I want to start with talking about why now, or why when you started putting this book together was, you know, the last year the right time, especially as Broadway was closed. I would imagine that's been such a juxtaposition for you of your life and like the difference between writing the first three and this new edition.
Definitely. You know, what was crazy was, like, it's a multi-part answer, but, you know, we always intended there to be 6 volumes because each volume of The Untold Stories of Broadway tells the stories of about 7 Broadway theaters and 1 lost Broadway theater. So in order to do all of the houses, you know, there'd be about 6 volumes. And honestly, the first 3 came out in pretty, like, quick, rapid succession. And then volume 4 took a minute because I was busy doing things like producing Be More Chill and, like, other, you know, projects happened. And so when the, you know, quarantine started, and I think we're all experiencing this where we're like, oh wow, it's been a year. So like, what was life like a year ago? And just remembering the beginning of quarantine when we all thought it might just be a little while. And it was like, oh, well, if we have a month of dealing with this horrible thing, then like, I'll have some time to write, which was the initial instinct, which was like, okay, here's like a pause. And so I know that, you know, there's all kinds of perspectives on that, on people, you know, struggling to create, which I certainly have had as well. But for me, part of it was, I was like, okay, I do have this time. So I'm finally gonna be able to like write volume 4. And then as the pandemic went on and we realized like just how long we would really be dealing with this for, it was, oh my God, like what an opportunity to celebrate Broadway and to write something about how essential Broadway is and to carry forth these stories and to like, you know, carry forth the legacies of the interviewees who have passed away since, you know, I interviewed them and all of these things during this, you know, tragic time when Broadway is on pause and when the world is dealing with such trauma. So it was all of those things really. And then now that the book's come out, it's just become clear as I've like talked to interviewees and people that have worked on it, like it does have these like, you know, hidden layers that it might not if it came out during another time.
Yeah. Now the chapters and all of the parts of the book, you know, take us inside these Broadway theaters, some of which no longer exist, some of which we're all familiar with and used to go see shows in, you know, all the time. But for you, these were your second homes, right? You haven't been in them like me for over a year. I know. Did you get to, in the name of research, writing, what have you, I won't tell, sneak back into any of these houses in order to get the book out?
You know, I didn't. It was so weird because I'm used to writing these books and being like, oh, I'm writing about, you know, the Winter Garden in 1950. So I'm going to go see a show at the Winter Garden tonight. And, you know, that spot that someone talked about in 1950, I'm going to take a look at it and see what it's like now. And I didn't get to do any of that. But that said, because I had done the majority of the interviews and the, you know, even some of the research prior to this, I did have like the roots of everything. And it was fascinating to both only be able to see the outsides of the theaters and to have to reconstruct a lot more than usual from memory. Because a lot of the times when I'm writing reading these books, I'll be like, oh, well, this person said this and this person said that. So I'll go talk to the doorman at that theater. And, you know, there is an ability to do a lot of that virtually, as we've all been kind of tackling. But there were certain moments when, like, the lack of access to the physical spaces provided, like, a different obstacle. And that said, though, it just kind of made me remember more of, like, what it was like to treasure the theaters from afar and want to study them as someone who didn't get to see Broadway shows yet. So yeah, it added a lot of interesting stuff. There were also, interestingly enough, a few things that we couldn't even find the answers to, but not because of the theaters being closed, because of the libraries being closed. So, you know, like we usually talk about for the lost Broadway theaters, for all of them actually, but for the lost theaters, it was hard to find out who had owned them over the years and like how they'd exchanged hands. And so we truly put in a footnote that was like, this couldn't be found because the Schubert Archive and the Library of Congress and New York Public Library are closed. So there were things like that that were interesting to navigate as we went through the book.
We've talked about in our last interview or that you spent a lot of time over this last year taking walks through the city, taking walks through the theater district. Even though you were only able to look in, I feel like, you know, there's a Dear Evan Hansen song coming. But, you know, from only being able to look from the outside of these theaters, did you glean like new insight on what was happening at certain historical points inside, what was happening in the writings and the research you were doing on these houses now?
Totally. And what's been interesting, I think, for a lot of us who spent time in Midtown during the shutdown is, depending on what juncture of quarantine the pandemic it's been, 8th Avenue and sometimes 9th Avenue have really felt like another era. You know, I remember walking on 8th Avenue at like 11 p.m. a couple months ago, and it was truly deserted. Like there wasn't a person on the stretch of 8th Avenue, like in the 40s, and going like, and it felt a little bit more dangerous than usual. And like, you know, just thinking about other times when Times Square was different and when like, the, you know, there's not an exact parallel, but because I'm writing specifically about the 1982 when all of the theaters were demolished to build the Marriott Marquis, it's interesting to think about both the parts of Times Square that are empty and like what it feels like when theaters are more abandoned, and also like, you know, the 8th Avenue, 9th Avenue of it all, just like wrapping your brain around that.
Absolutely. You talked about in this book or how the theater has always also made you feel connected to New York City. How have you retained that connection to where you live, where when the spaces that, as I just said, you know, you used to call your second home, or I'm going to say, I can understand that, you know, tie have all been closed.
You know, what's interesting that like you just made me think about this, but it's true that I haven't been inside the theaters and none of us have. And that's been like so terrible. But the fact is like I can take a walk any day and go, you know, stand outside the Niederlander and like the Schubert and like they're still here. And like those theaters are, you know, semi-permanent. And like the fact that one of the major takeaways from this book, from the Lost Broadway Theater chapter, was that like it was such a tragedy when those five theaters were demolished in 82, but it really led to the landmarking of all the other Broadway theaters because the protests and like the uprising to save those theaters didn't work, but it did lead to other theaters being saved. And thinking about that in terms of like, you know, during the pandemic, I can't see all my friends. I can't go to a show. I can't go to a party. I can go walk on 52nd Street and see that like those theaters are still here and they will eventually have shows in them. Like I know they will. So in a way it's been comforting. Like a lot of people have described feeling really sad walking through the empty theater district, and there's that too. But for me, I'm like, yo, like we have survived a lot. And thinking about, you know, I remember at some point looking at a specific year of the early 90s and going like, oh, half the Broadway theaters were empty. There have been very troubling times of all different sorts, and like the theater district remains and Broadway like perseveres. So it's actually been kind of uplifting for me.
That's like a wonderful point. When you see these, you know, when you see that they still stand, you know that you're going to be walking into them one day and they're not going anywhere, even though we don't know. Well, that's something I would like to hold on to. I also liked how you mentioned in the book that, you know, theater is a grand tradition. It's all about traditions, but in a year when we don't have the specific tradition of seeing a show and everything that goes on into it, have you noticed new traditions within the community arising, or, you know, things that have come about because we haven't had shows to produce, perform, and go see?
Definitely. You know, I really think like we'll hopefully see, and I think we will, a lot of like hybrid art forms like coming out of this. Like I'm really hopeful that there will be ways that like live performance and streamed performance can like combine when we are able to safely have live performance so that they're more accessible. I think we're all kind of hoping that. But also like there have been so many interesting forms of outdoor theater. There have been so many like school and like, you know, amateur productions that have like kind of made new strides in doing things unconventionally. And so I just think that like we're going to see those things continue in some way. Like, I don't think we'll all be, you know, obviously doing Zoom readings forever, but there are certain ways that the virtual reality of it all and the like outdoor reality will change the next era of theater that'll be interesting to see.
When you looked back into the theaters that you were covering for Volume 4 and how the industry has changed over the decades, do you think as well looking forward that one day when we are so far beyond this, whether it's decades or centuries from now, what will have changed for the theater because of the pandemic, and you know, what we'll have learned coming out of this as so many, you know, an industry did so many decades ago?
Totally. Yeah, there were so many fascinating things in this volume more than in any other volume that like my editor and I, we would constantly be like, you know, I think when this started, there was a lot of idea about like how Broadway recovered from 9/11. It was like a big topic of conversation because just, you know, there that is the in recent memory the most comparative time that we could like think of. But specifically with like Broadway recovering from certain moments and also just with other issues we're dealing with now, there were so many things I came upon in this book of like you know, the history of like racist criticism, the history of like sexism in hiring practices, the history of like people being skeptical of radio plays because they thought it would deter people from seeing theater in person. It was just like endless topics of like, you know, the Federal Theater Project hiring out of work actors to like work for theater through the government. Like, it was so many things that I was like, it's not exactly the same. Like, that's the point is that like it's not exactly the same in 2021, but there's so much to be learned. And people do like don't necessarily know history and think that like we're inventing everything that happens as it happens, but there are so many moments that have happened before in different ways.
All right, let's look forward now. As you've explored these houses, what houses that are on Broadway now or in the theater district as a whole are going to be in the best shape to open when Broadway finally does come the fall?
That's a great question, and I'm sure you know it's something we've all been talking about. You know, I think the general sentiment is that the shows that are like really have been running a while, the long-running shows, will have the capacity to return because they can withstand, you know, an initial amount of loss while, you know, people figure out capacity and safety and how this is all going to work and like will people come back to the theater? How long will it take them to return? So there are shows that are long runners that can, you know, as always, like withstand, you know, the cold winter months of it all. In this case, cold winter months means like the initial return. But then there's also the idea that like there are these new shows that were poised to open, like Diana, which just announced today that, you know, they're going to go back on sale for a specific date in the winter, fall, December. And you know, Six and shows that like very much company are definitely gonna open. But I think like those shows might open a beat after the initial long-running shows. And it'll be interesting to see because we've really never had anything like this where it's like, you know, three shows could open in October, reopen, and then three shows could reopen in November. We could have like a wave, which I think the sentiment is that that will be smart because people will be gradually returning. So giving them, you know, that slow, like short, lower amount of options at first might be a good idea.
In terms of safety, though, too, the infrastructure of these houses that are, I would imagine, some of them over 100 years old, how are producers and owners looking in terms of the safety of a post-pandemic audience coming into them? Like, can HVAC systems be changed in this house, in these houses, or replaced? You know, what do we do to maintain the history, but also make sure that they're safe for when audiences return?
Yeah, it's a good question. I feel like from the perspective of someone who like obviously cares about these spaces so much from a historical perspective, I don't think there's a single thing that would prevent the spaces from being made more safe. You know, most of our Broadway theaters were built without, you know, air conditioning, without modern air conditioning, and that was put in. There's no reason why like, you know, modern and safe filtration systems and door handles and all these kind of precautions that people are looking into and that, you know, even the city and state are requiring can't be implemented in these Broadway houses. I think, you know, my my thought and prediction is that they'll all be equally safe once they all do take, you know, the precautions necessary to make people feel safe, to actually make them safe, and to, like, you know, inspire confidence in the theater.
And what do you want audiences, your readers, to know about Broadway coming back? We hear it that it's going to happen, but where do you think we are on getting on track to actually seeing an opening day for some theaters for a show?
You know, I think there'll be theater this summer. I don't think there'll be Broadway, but I do think there'll be, like, smaller theaters. We're seeing outdoor stuff start to happen. We're seeing some regional stuff. There's a lot of regional theaters that have the ability to do things that Broadway theaters and even New York just don't. You know, they have more space. They have more outdoor. They have, like, those options. So the main thing, and I really feel like this needs to be where the messaging shifts to, so I'm glad you asked, is, like, we've spent a year being like, this is how you support actors. This is how you support theater professionals. And I think it's shifting a little where, like, one of the main things you're going to have to do to support if you want to and are able to is, like, buy a ticket, or, like, if you can't go to the theater, buy someone else a ticket, or, like, you know, it's going to be like, support your local theater, support your New York theater. Like, when tickets are on sale and shows are coming back, go to the theater, even if it's not, like, your first choice show but your fifth choice show, like, go. And right. So I think we will start to see the sentiment start to spin around that.
Are you ready for night one? Are you going to be in, you know, the invited dress? Are you just raring to go?
Totally. And I think that that'll be an exciting thing about the gradual reopening too, right? Like, you and I can be at, like, multiple first nights because they won't all be on the same night, right? Like, how are you?
Three shows in a month. It'll feel like the last week of April, and it'll be wonderful before all of this, you know? Three shows in 1 month, we're going to be like, oh no, it's too much. It's, you know, can't they spread this out?
That's so true. And yet I'm looking forward to, like, overdosing. How are you feeling about it?
I can't wait. And I'll be there ready to, I'll probably be, like, you know, cavelling and then kvetching, you know, 2 seconds later, because that's what we do as audience members and New Yorkers, and all in the name of love.
I will say, though, like, theater people, I think that if we're in a theater situation where masks are required, which they likely will be, yeah, and someone isn't wearing a mask, like, theater people will say something like that.
Oh,
will
my
not
gosh. You think it was okay for you to open your lozenger before now? No. It's going to be 10 times.
Yes. I just, like, I keep imagining this because, you know, when you're at the supermarket and you're like, oh, that one person's wearing their mask below their nose and it's annoying and nobody's saying anything. Should I say something? And I don't think it'll be like that at the theater. I think if you're sitting at the booth and someone has their mask below their nose, it's going to be like 10 people being like, right, how dare you?
Including the actors. Yeah. We're going to, yeah, Patti LuPone will come out, put your mask back above your nose, and then, yeah, return to the show. So, and we will love every minute of that, even though it's, you know, dicey. So, Jennifer, these are all good things to look forward to. In the meantime, get your fill of so much theater history with the Untold Stories of Broadway, Volume 4. 2 more to go. Can you hardly wait? Are you ready for a little break?
I am both. I'm ready for a little break, and then sometimes I'm like, oh my God, I haven't done the music box yet. So it goes both ways. But thank you so much for having me.
You're very welcome. Come back again and again and again. We'll talk theater more and more and more, I'm sure, in the coming months. Jennifer, thanks so much for being here. Don't forget, like and subscribe. Before we say goodbye, like and subscribe to the Let's Talk About It YouTube channel. This has been Let's Talk About It. We'll talk to you next time.